I'm going to read Psalm 9 once my recognizes me. Psalm 9, verse 1 and 2 says, I will give thanks to the Lord with my whole heart. I will recount all of your wonderful deeds. I will be glad and exalt in you. I will sing praise to your name, O Most High. Then Psalm 8 is what we're going to sing. It says, O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. So let's praise our God. Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. The heavens declare your greatness. Oceans cry out to you. Mountains, they bow down before you. So I'll join with the earth and I'll give my praise to you. Again. Oh Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. The heavens declare your greatness, the oceans cry out to you, mountains they bow down before you, so I'll join with the earth and I'll give my praise to you. Thank you that we can be here, fellowship with the saints, worship and praise your name, hear your word. Just ask now that you bless the service, bless the message, bless our time together in Jesus' name. Amen. Welcome to Bridge Bible Fellowship again. Wow, good to see you. And here it is on a weekend holiday and this place is packed. Love it. We're going to be celebrating the Lord's Supper today, so let's prepare our hearts for that.
Table of the King.
share in this bread of life, and we drink of this sacrifice as a sign of our bonds of love. Around the table of the King, the blood that cleanses every stain of sin shed for you. Drink and remember the drink-less cup that all may enter in to receive the life of God. So we share in this bread of life, and we drink of His sacrifice as a sign.
Good morning, everybody. Let's start by praying together. Would you join with me, please? Father in heaven, thank you for this morning. We thank you for the gift of this day. Thank you for your grace and the opportunity to gather and worship on this new Sabbath day. We thank you for the special time we have this morning as we celebrate communion as well. We ask your blessing on the service, the fellowship, the singing, Sunday school, and the sermon, all of it. Father, would you be glorified in it? We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, it's great to see you all this morning. Welcome to Bridge Bible Fellowship. My name's Kirk, and I'm going to share with you a few announcements and lead us this morning in communion as we get ready to do that. Before we get ahead of ourselves, I just wanted to mention when you came in this morning, you got your bulletin. I always want to highlight a couple things there. Take a look. It's full of information. How to get connected, if you have questions, if you're new, if you're just trying to figure out why we do some of the things that we do and how things are ran here, you have access there. But two things that are noted on there, just a continued reminder of our sort of welcome brochure that's more than just welcoming new people. It's also trying to get people connected. So there's ways, if you have questions for an elder, if you have, hey, I want to know how you do the small groups and how do I get involved, if you'd like to get in our directory, which we continue to go back to because it's just a great way to communicate when we have multiple services and it's hard to get to know each other, all that stuff's back on that back table. So you can check it out, fill it out, put it in the offering box on your way out if you want, and we'll get in touch with you and get you squared away. The other thing is it's coming fast, but the women's retreat here in just a couple weeks, really, the 23rd through the 25th. All the information's on the bulletin there. If you have questions or you're wondering how to find out more, come talk to me and I can direct traffic and get you in touch with somebody. So I wanted to bring that to your attention. This morning, it's the first Sunday of the month, and at Bridge Bible Fellowship, we reserve the first Sunday of the month for communion, the Lord's Supper. And just by way of some explanation and some background here before we partake together, it's communion or the Lord's Supper is one of two ordinances or sacraments that the church practices, one the other being baptism. And this event was instituted by Jesus to commemorate his death, and it symbolizes the new covenant that he created to point the fellowship of the redeemed people together to his table and anticipate what's yet to come. So that's sort of by definition, that's what's going on here. The final meal that Jesus had with his disciples, as we're coming into that season in our series through Matthew, it was immediately before his betrayal and his arrest, and during the traditional, what would have been the Passover meal. Jesus took the Passover meal and then he infused it, right, with some new significance in light of his upcoming death. In Matthew 26, he says, Matthew says, "Now as they were eating, Jesus took bread and after blessing it, broke it and gave it to the disciples. And he said, 'Take and eat, this is my body.' And then he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, 'Drink it, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins.'" So Jesus, in doing that, he symbolically associated the bread and the cup with his body, that what was soon to take place, his body broken for us on the cross and his blood poured out, shed for sins, right? So the blood, he explains, is the new covenant. The new covenant that Jesus instituted through his death and through his resurrection. And it's foundational saving act in what we are here, why we're here, and how we exist with the forgiveness of sins. And so it's an interesting bridge that he built between the Passover, that he was, the feast that he was celebrating, the fact that the Jews would commemorate this time when they were saved, they were passed over by way of the angel of death. He then similarly said, "Hey, we're going to institute the Lord's Supper." That's going to reflect on this new Passover where God passes over us in judgment because he pours it out on his son on the cross, and he took care of our sin by way of the perfect sacrifice that Jesus was. So his institute of this meal makes it clear that the meal serves as a symbol of the new covenant and the remembrance of his death. And so when we take this, the scripture is not real explicit on the frequency to do it. And so we have just, it says regularly, do it regularly to commemorate, to remember what he has done. And so we've chosen to do it at the beginning of the month, the first Sunday of every month together. And so as we do, there's a couple of things to keep in mind. I've heard it said before that, you know, pay attention to where you look when we take communion. And there's a couple of things in light of what is meant by that, the way you look. First and foremost, we look up. We look up to the Lord, what he has done, with gratitude to Jesus, right? Thanksgiving, his death on the cross. But we also, we take time to look around, and we do this as a gesture of unity and fellowship together with each other on this special Sunday. And it's not just here, you know, there's Christians around the world that are celebrating communion, the Lord's Supper, in the same regard. So we don't require at Bridge Bible here, we don't require that you be a member here. We require what scripture requires, that you profess Jesus as Lord, you believe in your heart that he has been raised from the dead. And if that's true of you, if you've received his forgiveness of sin, then we invite you to come and to take with us and to commemorate, to remember this event. But we also look forward to the day when he'll return. That's part of this experience too, that there will come a day when Jesus will return. And so we make a declaration this morning and we take the Lord's Supper. But lastly, I also like to encourage us, we look inwardly. You know, there's in 1 Corinthians, Paul makes it super clear when he discusses this very event that we're going to partake in. And he says in chapter 11, verse 27, "Therefore, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty concerning the body and the blood of the Lord. Let a person examine himself then, and so eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without discerning the body eats and drinks judgment on himself." So an intricate part of this is to reflect and to pray and to consider where you're at with the Lord, and to thank him, to confess maybe sins, to deal with areas that have yet to be dealt with, whatever it might be. And so there's time for that. I'm going to ask the gentlemen that are going to serve the elements to come on forward. And as those elements go out, that's our time to look inwardly and to consider, you know, where am I doing this with the right heart? Is this just a ritual, or am I honoring the Lord with what this event is? We ask you to hold the bread and hold the cup, and we'll take it all together once everybody has it. But in the meantime, as the elements go out, consider those things, looking up, looking around, looking ahead and looking in within.
Thank you.
As I mentioned in 1 Corinthians 11, Paul simply says this in recalling this very event and leading. He quotes Jesus and he says, "I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, he took the bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and he said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" And in the same way also, he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Father in heaven, we do thank you for this special occasion. We thank you for your Son, who for his shame and our benefit bore our sin, endured the cross, scorned its shame, and now sits at the right hand of you, our Father. Thank you for the forgiveness of sins. Thank you for the opportunity to remember what you have done, and in faith to know that the best is yet to come. We thank you that you promised to return, and we anticipate that day. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, we're going to continue on this morning. Families, parents, if you'd like to send your kids downstairs to Children's Church, to Sunday School, you can do that now, or you can keep them up here with us, and we're going to go ahead and stand and continue in song.
Thanks, Kirk. Let's continue, and I misplaced my pick. Can you believe it? Between here and there, I misplaced the pick. Oh, well.
To my feet and a light unto my
my path. When I feel afraid, I think I've lost my way. Still, you're there right beside me. Nothing will I fear as long as you are near. Please be near me to the end. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. I will not forget your love for me, and yet my heart forever is wandering. Jesus, be my guide and hold me to your side. I will love you to the end. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. And a light unto my path.
You can be seated.
You hear me the second time? Good morning. Here we go.
Okay, we're on.
All right, we're in Matthew chapter 23 this morning. Matthew chapter 23 is Jesus' last sermon. His first sermon was back in Matthew chapter 5, 6, and 7, which is the Sermon on the Mount. And this is his last public sermon anyway that's recorded. We do have some more conversations he has with the disciples, but this is the last public sermon. And so I was thinking about that. I mean, all of Jesus' sermons are important, but there's something about the last sermon that maybe is a little bit different. I don't know. So to try to find a point of comparison, I went and looked at speeches by Churchill, Churchill's last speech before he died, and Martin Luther King Jr. and JFK, and some other famous people who had given many speeches, and maybe their last one might be different in some way. One interesting one that has some points of comparison is Abraham Lincoln's final speech. He gave his speech on a Tuesday, April 11th, 1865, which was 2 days after the war was done. And that week in April happened to be Easter week. And one member in the audience was John Wilkes Booth, who heard Lincoln's speech and didn't like what Lincoln had to say, and 3 days later did in fact kill him. And killed him on Friday, April 14th, 1865. And there's a little bit of external similarities there. I mean, Jesus' final public speech was on a Tuesday, and he was dead on Friday. And in the audience, there were those that are listening to Jesus that are, in fact, going to kill him shortly. But those similarities are actually a little bit superficial, because if you read Lincoln's speech, his final speech, it's a little bit mundane, a little bit kind of lackluster, nothing really special about it except that it's going to be his last. But he didn't know that. You know, he did not know that he was going to die, and that's a big difference, because on another case, in Jesus' case, he knew it. He knew he was going to die shortly, and so he picked his words accordingly. You know, his words aren't lackluster at all. They're rather hard words to read. They're not soft platitudes. They do echo many of the same themes in his first sermon from the Sermon on the Mount. So some of the same ideas are in his last sermon as well. But it's definitely much more biting in this last sermon. So let's pray, and then we'll dive into the text. Heavenly Father, we come before you, and we come to read your word. And your words this morning towards the Pharisees are particularly biting. I am not even Jewish, but the same type of heart we see here in this text is in me. it's in the heart of man. And so we ask you to help us deal with our pride and our hypocrisy and our sin, for these are common to man. So may these words dig deep. Praise things in your name. Amen. Well, last week, Martin gave us a good introduction, the first part of chapter 23, the first 12 verses, which are kind of an introduction to these religious leaders. And we're going to continue with this sharp criticism, picking it up in verse 13. And verse 13 starts, this is of chapter 23, verse 13, starts this way. But woe to you, scribes and Pharisees. And this word woe is going to occur seven or eight times. It is a Hebrew word and a Greek word, the same word. In Hebrew, it's the word oi, which sounds very Hebrew, Jewish, if you think about it. Oi, and it's the same word in Greek. And it's almost more of a sound than a word, right? It's almost just recording what this sounds like. And so the word translates to woe in many translations. And if you look up the meaning of woe and the meaning of oi, the translators have some interesting spins on it. One said, oi means what terrible pain is to come your way. Yikes. Another one said, how greatly you will suffer. So these are very harsh words of judgment and condemnation. He's going to, like I said, use this word woe or oi seven or eight times. And the first woe that we read here acts kind of a little bit of a summary and a thesis for the other woes, which are all related. They're different woes, different reasons for condemnation. However, they're all kind of similar and related. So we're going to take the first two woes kind of together. And verse 13 is our first one. It says, but woe or oi to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you shut the kingdom of heaven in people's faces, for you neither enter yourselves nor allow those who would enter to go in. So what is this first woe? Well, I mean, to start with, you can see that he's talking to people that he says are not going to be in heaven, but that's kind of a minor point. I mean, it's true that unforgiven sin will keep you out of heaven, but there's something worse going on here. It's bad enough when you yourself do not get into heaven, but it's worse because these are the leaders. And Jesus, throughout this whole text of Matthew, reserves his sharpest barbs, his sharpest criticism for hypocritical religious leaders. And why is that? Well, I mean, for one very practical reason is that, you know, their sins do not only affect themselves, they affect others. And so he's pretty direct here. Jesus says, you know, they aren't going to heaven themselves, and they even put roadblocks in the way of others. They either they actually prevent others from pursuing God. What sort of roadblocks? Well, the Pharisees taught a number of things, some of which were correct, some of which weren't. But two particular ones that I want to highlight that were problematic. One is that they cast doubt that Jesus was the Messiah all through Jesus' ministry. They outright opposed him. And this is a public thing, so it's not just them personally that are opposing him. They're opposing him for the nation of Israel, for their teaching that Jesus is not the Messiah. They're swaying others. They called him Beelzebub. They called him Satan. Now, even among the Pharisees, there were some exceptions, like Nicodemus. I mean, Nicodemus comes to Jesus, you know, kind of humbly and says, we know that you're a teacher from God, and help me understand. But by and large, as a whole, the Pharisees rejected Jesus as the Messiah and taught that. Secondly, these particular religious leaders were especially known for their intense focus on being very pious and holy and religious, which in itself wouldn't be bad, except this led to a very serious case of self-righteousness. They were very proud of their compliance to the law, and further, they thought that their compliance to the law would made them morally superior. And this became their basis for being right with God, or so they thought. So here's the introduction. You have done this. Now, the second woe is very similar. As we're going to lump these together, the second woe is very similar. Verse 15. Oi, woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you travel across sea and land to make a single proselyte. And when he becomes a proselyte, you make him twice as much a child of hell as yourself. So you remember way back in chapter 12, I mentioned it before, that Jesus was called Beelzebub by the Pharisees. They said, you are Satan himself. Well, here Jesus returns the favor. He says, you're you're children of hell. That's pretty strong. I mean, that's like this whole passage. It's pretty strong condemnation. He's not just talking, hey, you need to shape up a little bit or you need to tweak your teaching. This is, no, you're children of hell. So this image that some pseudo-religious people have about Jesus being all loving and kind and my Jesus, well, he loves people. Love, love, love. Well, it's totally true. It's totally true. But let's not stop there. He loved Jerusalem enough to warn them very strongly about false teachers. That's how much he loved Jerusalem. Not to pander to them or say that everything's fine. He loved Jerusalem strong enough that he said, these teachers of yours are children of hell. Now, a proselyte is a convert, and so he mentions their converts here. Rabbis had disciples or students. It says in the text in Matthew that they had disciples. And some of these disciples or students and followers were, in fact, converts to Judaism. Now, to be a convert to Judaism, that wasn't trivial. It took some serious commitment, especially if you're male. I guess my drift. And often that was a source of pride. It's like, oh, well, I have all these converts that have converted from being a Gentile or whatever, now they're Jews. And these second generation Pharisees, if you will, are sometimes the worst. I mean, that's true of other false teachers and cults. In other words, you know, a cult starts with one guy. A false teaching starts with one guy who teaches something that's off. And that second and third generation are sometimes worse than the first. The first guy gets it started, and it's not even sure if it's going to fly yet, but guess what? That second makes it systematic. So sometimes the children of these false teachers or the students or disciples of these false teachers are even worse. They're twice as much as a child of hell as themselves. Well, so what's the problem here? Well, we have this charge that they're a child of hell. We have this particularly sharp attack against them as being teachers. And one of the reasons I think that Jesus is getting on them is because they are, in fact, teachers. Here's the thing about teaching. I'm a teacher. Teaching works, for better or worse. I mean, good teaching works. Bad teaching is also very effective in a bad way, right? And so one of the verses as a teacher that I've kind of clung to, and I think there's some real insights here, it's out of Luke. This is Jesus speaking. Jesus says, can a blind man lead a blind man? Will they not both fall into a pit? A disciple is not above his teacher, but everyone, when he is fully trained, will be like his what? Be like his teacher. Now, if I didn't know, and I've read this before, maybe I think, well, when he's fully trained, let's get on my holy shoes here. I'd say, everyone when he's fully trained will be like Jesus. Well, we hope that's true too, but it doesn't say even mundane things. It doesn't say everybody when they're fully trained will be like his curriculum or like his textbook. What is it? Be like his teacher. Be like his teacher. There's special requirements for being a teacher and a special accountability for being a teacher. A student when he's fully trained will be like them. And so this is serious. I mean, the Pharisees are teaching, of course. They're teaching some false doctrines. But we're getting taught too. Who do you learn from? Do you learn from a good teacher, or do you learn from a child of hell? And you know what? Sometimes it's hard to tell the difference. Sometimes it's not always easy to, on the surface, figure that out. And that's why Jesus, I think, is giving the sermon. Or one reason he's giving the sermon is as he's preparing to leave, as he's preparing this one last sermon, he's not only condemning the Pharisees standing in front of him in a pretty strong language, woe to you Pharisees, he's also warning the rest of the people and us about false teaching. Well, let's move on to the next woe, verse 16. Woe to you blind guides who say, if anyone swears by the temple, it is nothing. But if anyone swears by the gold of the temple, he is bound by his oath. You blind fools. For which is greater, the gold or the temple that has made the gold sacred? And if you say, if anyone swears by the altar, it is nothing. But if anyone swears by the gift that is on the altar, he is bound by his oath. You blind men. For which is greater, the gift on the altar that makes the gift sacred? So whatever swears by the altar swears by it and by everything on it. And whoever swears by the temple swears by it and by him who dwells in it. And whoever swears by heaven swears by the throne of God and by him who sits upon it. So here we have this word swear mentioned a bunch of times. It's not a cuss word. In this case, swearing is an oath or a promise. So what's the problem with that? Well, one problem is that the Bible is not particularly keen on taking oaths. In the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus' first sermon, Jesus said, let your yes be yes and your no be no. Don't swear by things, just say yes or no and mean it. So that's from the Sermon on the Mount. And in here, he doesn't really address directly the idea of taking oaths. It's another related issue. And it's this idea the Pharisees had, this religious one-upmanship. So in other words, I will promise to do that. I'll promise by the temple. Oh, I'll promise by the gold of the temple. Oh, I'll swear by the altar. Oh, I'll promise or swear by the sacrifice that's on the altar, right? Now, remember, Pharisees are focused on the law. They're the lawyers. And lawyers tend to be nitpicky about words. You know, the subtle little nuances and shades of meaning, that's really big to, in law. And so here we have an oath or a promise. You know, and in law today, we might have a contract or an agreement. Is an agreement the same thing as a contract? Well, ask a lawyer. I asked Jim, and he kept on talking, because in the legal world, there's a subtle difference between an agreement and a contract, but not in every case, right? So a contract is a little bit stronger sometimes, but not always. Well, it's not just in the legal world. You know, if we have a bet or a dare or something like that, you know, you watch elementary kids in the playground, and I've watched them. What's the difference between a dare and a double dog dare, huh? A double dog dare is, you know, one-upping, right? And if you go to the triple dog dare, I don't know if it goes much beyond that, right? So it's this one-upmanship, and this is kind of a religious one-upmanship that's going on here. So there's an application there about, you know, trying to one-up each other in a religious sense or over religious things. Another broad application is here, I think, is we have this tendency to put an emphasis on the wrong things. We have a tendency to make the wrong kind of distinctions. Oh, is it the temple or the gold of the temple? And make a big deal about these things that are not really that important. We put value on the wrong things in our life. And that's kind of what the next woe is too, so let's jump into that. It's more or less the same thing. So verse 23 is the next woe. Woe or oi to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites. For you tithe mint and dill and cumin, and they have have neglected the weightier matters of the law, justice and mercy and faithfulness. These you ought to have done without neglecting the others, you blind guides, straining out a gnat and swallowing a camel. So my wife grows a few herbs in the backyard. She has a little pots, you know, a couple little pots of oregano and thyme and rosemary. Every once in a while she'll cut off a little bit and bring it inside and let it dry out. We'll use it in something or other, and it's good. And so think about these same spices. That's what the Pharisees were doing, but they also were lawyers and picked sticklers for detail, and so they looked at the Old Testament requirement to tithe 10% of your harvest. And so they'd take that dill and bring it in, and they'd take a little 10% out, and they'd go deliver it to the synagogue or something, presumably, right? Now, should we give, if you grow little herbs in your backyard or in pots like we do, should you give a little bit of that to God, that little bit of harvest? I guess you can. I mean, I think the Old Testament tithe requirement was for commercial crops, for income. I don't know that it necessarily meant, you know, that little pot of dill there, but that's okay. I guess you can give some away. But this is what the Pharisees carefully did, you know, to kind of show how serious they were about tithing. Okay, that's fine. I mean, it's not a problem to give something to God, even if it's a little pinch of dill or mint or something. What is the problem there? The problem is that they were very carefully tithing that 10% and weighing it out. And they're missing the bigger things. What bigger things? He mentions justice and mercy and faithfulness. Those are really, really big things. But, you know, forget that little pinch of spice, of mint. What about those things? These big things cover a ton of ground, right? A ton of ground. I mean, you could start writing applications for justice and, you know, meaning how to apply it for justice and mercy and faithfulness. You'd never end. These are what I would call kind of an overarching rule or principle of justice, mercy, and faithfulness that always applies. And there's other things in our life that they're like that. For example, if you're 15 or 16, you might be familiar with the Idaho Driver's DMV Handbook, right? It has rules for driving, and there's a lot of rules. Rules about how far to have your blinker on, and rules regarding speed, you know, speed in, what, you know, in the school zones and construction zones and residential zones, freeways, you know, is there a minimum speed on the freeway, and all these rules and speed limits, right? And in Moscow, if you're coming into the town, it says it's Moscow speed limit is 35 unless otherwise posted. Okay, that's all well and good. Okay, you know the speed limit. That's important, right? Well, let me ask you this. If the speed limit is 55 and you're going 53, can you still get a speeding ticket? Yes, you can. You actually can. Why is that? If you're going 53 and a 55, why is that? There's something called the basic rule, which is a law in Idaho, which is the basic rule says you need to drive at a speed that is reasonable and prudent, no matter what the speed limit actually is. In other words, there's times when 53 is too much, given the weather or conditions or other things going on. You can get a ticket, a speeding ticket, for going less than. In other words, the overarching rule is this basic rule that says drive safely and wisely. There are specifics here, yes. And so, you know, the Pharisees are all caught in the specifics of tithing this little bit of mint, and they're losing track of the big concept, which is, it's like the basic rule, which is what? Justice and mercy and faithfulness. Those always apply. The basic rule in Idaho always applies, no matter what the weather. This is not a new thing. Jesus is not springing something new on them. He's talked about it before, but it also comes from the Old Testament. One example that's out of Micah 6, which we sometimes sing the last part of this as a song. But look at the whole thing and what's going on here in Micah 6. With what shall I come before the Lord and bow myself before God on high? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with 10,000s of rivers of oil? Shall I give my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? He has told you, O man, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you, but to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with your God. Okay, this is right from the Old Testament. There are other passages that are similar. Does God want offerings and gifts? Does he want your tithes? Well, sort of, but not really. I mean, does God want your stuff? Well, you know, the gifts you give to God may reflect a kind heart, but if they don't, he doesn't want them. He doesn't need that stuff. He doesn't need any of that. Does he really want thousands of rams? Well, no, he doesn't. He wants your heart. He wants your heart. And following these laws, you know, some of the laws of tithing is maybe a good thing, God wants your heart. So back to Matthew 23. In Matthew 23, Jesus says you're missing some of these things. You're missing righteousness and justice and mercy. And then in summer he says you're straining at a gnat and swallowing a camel. And that's a really great image, right? The strain of a gnat and swallow a camel. And apparently there's some evidence that this is what they would do. The Pharisees did not want to eat a bug. So they would, when they're pouring their, you know, some wine out of a flask or something like that, they'd put a piece of cloth over there to strain out any bugs that might have gotten into that, right? You can't be too careful. I mean, have you ever eaten a bug? I have. I mean, I've learned to close my mouth when riding a bike, right? I mean, I don't want to eat bugs, and neither do Pharisees, and they have another reason. Jews do not want to eat bugs because bugs are unclean. So to show how careful they were, to be extra careful about this, they might strain that drink when they're pouring it in there, whatever it is, to strain out any stray gnat that might have gone in there. You can't be too careful. But Jesus says, okay, you're busy straining out those gnats. Okay, fine. I mean, no one wants to eat bugs. But you're swallowing a camel. Now, a camel was also unclean. Okay? Just like the gnat. The gnat and the camel are both unclean. So what's the difference? There's a big difference, right? There's literally a big difference. You can inadvertently swallow a gnat or a bug accidentally, but you're not going to accidentally swallow a camel. I don't think so. Not going to happen. And Jesus doesn't mince words here. He says there are weightier matters of the law. There are certain laws that are more important. Justice, mercy, faithfulness. And you're busy out weighing out your that little pinch of dill to turn it over to the synagogue as your offering. These overarching broad principles always apply. And you get hung up and possibly straining out a nap, but you're swallowing this camel. Well, the next two woes, starting in verse 25, will kind of take together. They kind of they more or less go together. So a double oy, right? Oy and oy. Starting with verse 25, woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you clean the outside of the cup and the plate, but inside they are full of greed and self-indulgence. You blind Pharisee, first clean the inside of the cup and the plate, that the outside also may be clean. Second woe, very similar. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you are like whitewashed tombs, which outwardly appear beautiful, but within are full of dead people's bones and all uncleanliness. So you also outwardly appear righteous to others, but within you are full of hypocrisy and lawlessness. So these two woes, kind of very similar, are very easy to understand. We had this inner versus outer, this inside versus outside. The outside of us is what people see. You know, the outside would be clothes and the food we eat and our public behavior. And man's traditions tend to focus on those things. What we eat, what we wear, these superficial things, you know, and that makes sense because, you know, when we're, that's all we can see. I mean, what we see is what we get. I mean, I can't read minds. I might be able to look at someone's behavior and maybe infer about their inner heart, but I can't see their inner heart, and I might be wrong. These outward things that we see, it's not that they're irrelevant, but they've got to be put in their proper place. Because the inside is what really matters. It's who we are. God cares about your heart. And that's this contrast here between the outside looking so good, but the inside being filthy and unclean. The dead bones are literally unclean in Jewish culture. And things that are unclean not only are a problem in and of themselves, they tend to contaminate others. So it's a very simple image of clean on the outside, but having a filthy, nasty heart. God is interested in the heart. Well, verse 29 continues this. Another woe, another oy. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites. For you build the tombs of the prophets and decorate the monuments of the righteous, saying, if we had lived in the days of our fathers, we would not have taken part with them in shedding the blood of the prophets. Thus, you witness against yourselves that you are sons of those who murdered the prophets. Fill up then the measure of your fathers. You serpents, you brood of vipers, how are you to escape being sentenced to hell? Okay, again, strong words. He talked about tombs and whitewashed tombs in the last paragraph, and now he builds on that. He talks more about tombs, but these are the tombs of what? The tombs of the murdered prophets. And here he reveals kind of a key characteristic of sin. I think this key characteristic of sin is how we respond to it. In other words, when we read or hear about people who sin, we say in our hearts, I wouldn't have done that. I'm better than that. And so this happens in all kinds of contexts. I mean, we can read, I'm on this kick, I'm reading a lot about World War II history, and I can read about this and go, wow, if I was back then, I would have stood up and done this. I would have been the good guy here. Or we read about somebody that's arrested, you know, in Hollywood, and we say, I'm glad I'm not like that guy, right? But we do it in church, too. In church, we open the Bible, and we read about, like the Pharisees did here, we read about some of the people in the Old Testament, and read about the Israelites who were so unfaithful, and say, I would have been one of those faithful few. I would have been the Elijah, right? I would have stood up to Jezebel. I would have been faithful to God. I would have never put Jeremiah in the stocks or in that cistern. I never would have killed Zechariah. I would have been on Zechariah's side. And what Jesus does, he says, oh, you call them your fathers? Well, you're right, because you're their children. You come by it honestly. You do the same thing. And in fact, you're going to do the same thing. But this is a natural tendency of the human heart. The natural tendency of the heart is to see sin very clearly when it's in someone else. When my kids were very little and in Sunday school, the teacher was Corinne Matthews, and one day she told us a story that happened in Sunday school in my daughter's class. So I don't know, she was probably 5 or 4 or something like that. She told us that my daughter, they were explaining sin and what sin was, and my daughter said, yep, that's what my brother does. He gets lots of spanks, you know. And that's exactly the attitude, you know, and she gets by, she comes by it honestly. You know, that's an attitude she gets from her father, right? We all get it from our father that sin is really bad over there. Well, this final section, he's going to continue that thought, a little bit more commentary, but he's going to turn it into a little bit of prophecy too, okay? And a preview of what's to come, because he talks about killing the prophets, and he says, therefore, I send you prophets and wise men and scribes, some of whom you will kill and crucify, and some of you will flog, and some you will flog in your synagogues and persecute from town to town, so that on you may come all the righteous blood shed on earth, from the blood of righteous Abel to the blood of Zechariah the son of Berechiah, whom you murdered between the sanctuary and the altar. Truly I say to you, all these things will come upon this generation. All right, so he says, you know, you're going to kill. There's a prophetic aspect to this. Because, you know, Jesus is in the last few days of before the crucifixion. He's going to rise from the dead. And then the Christian church is going to start. And so not too many months from now, the deacon named Stephen is going to die a death very like this. He's the first Christian martyr in Acts chapter 7. In fact, because he's preaching the gospel, he is drugged before the Sanhedrin. Who is the Sanhedrin? The ruling members of Jews, including the high priest is there, it says. In other words, Stephen is probably brought before a lot of the guys Jesus is talking about now in a few months. It's coming very quickly. So this is a little bit prophetic, or a lot prophetic, about what is going to happen to some of these early church leaders, some of these followers of Christ. He says in here, the blood of everybody shed from Abel to the blood of Zechariah. It's kind of literally the beginning to the end. The first guy killed was Abel, all the way to Zechariah. It's also A to Z, like all the prophets. All these people killed are kind of, you're part of this collection of murderers. Well, let me conclude. This is where we'll stop today. We'll pick it up next week. But this is Jesus' last public sermon. This is the last public sermon, and you know, I was thinking about public sermons. I kind of ran across Abraham Lincoln, which is not really a sermon, more of a speech. But one of the ones that jumped out at me was Billy Graham's final sermon. You know, he was in his late 90s. He died when he was 99. He knew he was at the end of his life, and so he decides to give one last sermon. It's filmed because of his health. And what did he choose? He chose a salvation message. You know, not a surprise for Billy Graham. He chose a message that communicated the gospel. Now, what's curious here is Jesus knows that he's near the end of his life. And what did he choose to give? Well, it wasn't your traditional salvation message. Jesus could have said, let me reiterate what I said to Nicodemus. What I said to Nicodemus was, you must be born again. And what I said to Nicodemus was, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whoever believes in me should not perish but have everlasting life. Jesus didn't reiterate the gospel that way. And so I was wrestling with why this is. But I think part of it, this is my idea, I think part of it is simply that the Pharisees are in a certain place, and the reality is that you will not listen to the good news until you cope with the bad news. You aren't open to the idea of a savior until you admit that there's something wrong with yourself. There is good news, but it begins with something bad, and the Pharisees simply are not in a place to listen. So Jesus goes back to the problem, and the problem is sin. He goes back to the problem and says, "Oi, woe to you!" And it's a warning to the Pharisees who refuse to listen. But it's also a warning to the rest of us about what they're teaching. And it's a good warning for the rest of us, because the problem that the Pharisee says is the same problem that man has. You know, it's not just that the Pharisees were sinners. That certainly is a problem. But it's also, on top of that, it's the fact that they thought themselves to be impeccably righteous. That's a pretty big hurdle now. There's a big difference between a person who is a terrible sinner and knows it, and a person who is a terrible sinner and doesn't know it. It's another thing. So how do we know? Well, in the Old Testament, the prophet Amos gives a beautiful illustration that we've used before, but I really like it. The illustration he uses is God comes to Amos and says, I'm going to give you a plumb line. And a plumb line is a real simple device, just a weight on the end of a string, and it shows what is vertical. And if you put it up next to a wall or something like that, it'll show more clearly what is straight and true and what is vertical and what is not. And the plumb line in this analogy that Amos gives us is God's word. And in other words, the point is we need a standard. We need something to measure against that's correct. And God's word is that standard. And that wall may look pretty good, but you put that plumb line on, you realize that, wait a second, it's not quite vertical. The plumb line demonstrates that. So God's word is that, but here's the point with these hypocritical religious leaders, of which any of us could be. Never underestimate the power of man to make more plumb lines of his own. So God's word is a plumb line. It's the plumb line. John Calvin famously said that the human heart is a factory that creates idols. And it's a great, great image there too. But the human heart is also a factory that creates plumb lines. We invent these new standards of our own, and then we berate people for not living up to them. And so it's easy to say, well, that plumb line's fine, but I'm going to create some of my own too, these false plumb lines, and back them up with Bible verses that seem to fit. But when you start having these proliferation of all these plumb lines, what happens? You lose track of the real one. You lose track of God's word and get caught up in all the details on how much of that dill to tithe. And the Pharisees were guilty of this. They were caught up in the details of the law to such a degree that they missed the point. They missed the big things, the big plumb line, which said justice and mercy and righteousness. But, you know, it's pretty easy to pick on the Pharisees because we can see what they did historically, but in every heart, including mine, there's a corner of it that has this little Pharisee kind of tendency, this legalistic bent. And we throw that word around a lot. You know, legalism. What is legalism? It's simply trying to earn God's grace by following a list of rules. And legalism, despite what the Pharisees thought, does not result in holiness. It results in a guilt complex, this false guilt. And we all, in some place, no matter where you came from, we all have this heart for rules, rules that apply to other people. And I want them to follow my standard because I want to justify myself and make myself look good. And when I dig in my heels on my standards, it's because I have a lot of pride. I want others to copy this plumb line. So one of our problems is that we tend to think that, in contact to this plumb line, that we are lacking something. You know, if this is God's word, we're lacking something, a rule or behavior to be a real Christian. The Bible comes along and says, rest in the righteousness of Christ. We tend to think if I do something wrong, I need to do more to make it up. I need to add on more plumb lines to make up for it. Pray more or give more. But that's not the answer. That's trying to self-atone for your sin. May have had more plumb lines or different plumb lines. No. You know, all of religion in the world is man trying to get right through rules, through a different plumb line. But the plumb line never makes the wall straight. It can't. All the plumb line can do is it reveals something. It reveals that we are not cutting it. It demonstrates our need for a Savior. And I think that's why Jesus starts and ends with the Pharisees and their tendency to look towards themselves for their righteousness. We're going to pray, and then we'll sing a closing song. Heavenly Father, we ask for your help to avoid self-righteousness, which is hard to detect. We ask you to remove it out of us, you know, as painful as that can be. We ask you to help us to walk in humility and not in pride. Lord, we ask you to help us to see and apply and love the weightier matters of the law, of justice, mercy, and faithfulness. Praise things in your name. Amen.
Thanks, Lord. Let's stand and we'll sing our last song. Savior, show the world your love.
are strong to save in your mighty name, King in heaven come. We are children of your mercy, rescued for your glory. We cry, Jesus, set our hearts towards you. Every eye would see you lifted high. King of heaven, come down. King of heaven, come now. Let your glory reign, shining like the day. King of heaven, come. King of heaven, rise up. You can stand against us. You are strong to save in your mighty name. King of heaven, come. King of heaven.
We just ask, Father, that we be found faithful, that when you do come here, but help us to remember that there are those that are still lost, still that need your love, that need a Savior. Just ask that you send those people across to us, and as you do that, we remember that we need to talk to them about you. Thank you now for this day. Thank you for fellowship with the saints, for your word. In Jesus' name, amen. Have a great week.